15, excuse me, for the year 96-97. It's February 10th, 1997. Would you please, let's have the roll call before we do the pledge.
Chairman McLaughlin.
Here.
Counselor Cogswell.
Here.
Counselor Groff.
Here.
Counselor Jordan.
Yeah.
Counselor Linnell.
Here.
Counselor McGinty.
Here.
And Counselor Reed.
Here.
Thank you. Would you join me in the pledge to the flag, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Some of you may have had a chance to read the obituary section of the Portland Press Herald this morning. There was an obituary for Ruth W. Bean. Mrs. Bean served as town clerk in Cape Elizabeth from 1939 through 1960. From 1945 through 1960, she was the tax collector of the town. And then from 1963 to 1966, she was the first female elected as a selectman in Cape Elizabeth. I've had occasion to talk to two or three people today about Mrs. Bean and all of her dedicated work to the town. And what I gather is she truly epitomized customer service. People have told me that they were able to visit her at home. I think for the hunting license, I was hearing you could go any time, night or day, for the hunting license. I'm not sure she'd open up at night for a marriage license, but I do know that you could go to her home for a marriage license, and just was a remarkable woman in her dedication and her service to Cape Elizabeth. And Councilor Jordan, is there anything else about her history with the town that we need to mention?
Why do you think I go back to those days?
Because you told me so.
No, she was an awful nice person, and she's done a tremendous job as town clerk and what have you. And I myself am one of those people that went to her house in the evening to get a hunting license to go hunting the next day. And things like that, she was always willing to serve the people if she was there any time. And we always used to say, back to her, well, if I don't make the office, I'll make Bean's house. That's the second office.
Great, thank you. So I'd ask you all to join me in a moment of silence to remember Mrs. Bean. Thank you very much. We now have reports and correspondence from the council. Councilor Cogswell?
Yes, I just want to state that the Bridge Steering Committee for the opening ceremony is still hard at work, so that we'll have a festive moment to dedicate this new name for our new bridge. And we have not officially authorized any entities to do any fundraising yet, but we're in the process of doing that. And I also wanted to congratulate Cecily Upton of Cape Elizabeth, who won first place in the freestyle and 5K classical cross-country ski championships this weekend, and Betsy Wyman came in second in the freestyle. So it's good to see that we once again have cross-country skiers.
Thank you. Councilor Linnell.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I just want to announce that the Teen Coffee House had their first event since we last met. They've named it Oz. And the first night, they had something like 130 young people show up. It was, I think, very, very successful. It shows the need. And they are looking for some help in getting a cappuccino machine. So if anyone out there in TV land knows of a way to help Oz get a cappuccino machine, please get in touch with Ruth Watson. Thank you.
Thank you.
Care of the Methodist Church.
For Mrs. Watson. Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
No, I just want to, I don't have nothing to really report as far as RWS, but talking to Viv Chapel and what have you, that they haven't heard back from the DEP on their complaint as far as the emission and what have you. So maybe by, he says they got a couple of meetings this week, maybe by our next meeting, we have something to report on.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. McGovern, you had something you wanted to share?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. I just wanted to briefly update the town council on the planning that's been going on for the ball fields, both at Fort Williams and Lions Field. In back of me, you can see two plans that have been prepared by the firm of Oost Associates, our town engineers. These were discussed at a public meeting that was held a week ago this evening over at Public Works, where everyone was given an opportunity to look at the plans. There were probably about 10 citizens there. I think it was a very constructive process. This here is the proposed new Little League field at Lions Field. To orient you, Route 77 is coming across here. This is the entrance road. This is the current field. This is the new field. It's proposed to have this particular orientation. There'll be parking. It does comply with the proposed provision in terms of wetlands that is being recommended by the planning board. Generally, there was not a negative comment about it. In fact, one very positive thing happened at the meeting is there was discussion about the dugouts and whether or not to do them now or later, and the comment was made, well, certainly it's something that we could probably get someone to donate some blocks for, and it developed that one of the folks there owns a company that sells blocks and immediately volunteered to donate the blocks for the dugout, so that was very good to see happen. The second field is the one at Fort Williams Park. It's a soccer, lacrosse, field hockey field. This is Blake Road. This is where the Parks Maintenance Building, Portland Headlight, would be down here. This would be the road that eventually goes back out of the park. It does fit in fairly tightly. The major point of discussion, there was one citizen there who was quite concerned, wanted the field to drain this way instead of this way. The issue with the draining this way is that it tends to create a little more of a banking down in here. It was the feeling, I think, of everyone at the meeting, except for the one individual, that the field over the long term would drain this way. The individual did indicate that we ought to check with a few communities that have had it drain this way, and we're in the process of doing that, both the Director of Public Works and the engineer, just to be sure we're in good shape as to the way it drains. The plan would be to modify this slightly to come up with some additional comments, some additional detail on the plan. The engineer is going to be meeting with the town planner very soon to discuss what's necessary to go to a pre-application conference with the planning board in March, and then we would hope to go and actually for a permit in April to the planning board. Any questions on it? Thank you. Yes, Councilor Jordan.
Yeah, I just didn't quite get oriented on the larger field.
Yes, the original orientation was, this is Blake Road, which is the road that goes towards Delano Park. The original orientation was the field to go this way. As a result of the town council discussion, the field was moved 90 degrees, so it went this way.
Okay.
The only issue is, where is the crown of the field and how does it drain? And other than that, we seem to go along. There was also the plantings here. There was discussion that they'd like to see it spread out a little more and more natural. And I think it was agreement that, you know, fine, let's do what we can to try to make everyone happy with that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Ms. Lane, do you want to talk about the upcoming May election?
Thank you very much. Beginning on Wednesday, actually, February 12th, nomination papers are available in my office. There are 3 seats on the council and 3 seats on the school board available. They are due in my office Monday, March 24th, and you must obtain between 25 and 100 registered signatures of voters in Cape Elizabeth. So anyone interested, please let me know at Town Hall.
Thank you very much. Councilor Coxall.
Yes, I think this is probably the opportune time for me to announce that I will not be running for another term on the town council. Although I still have a very strong interest in town affairs, I feel very strongly that 3 consecutive terms is a reasonable amount of time to spend. And I want to thank all those voting citizens who gave me this opportunity to serve. And I very strongly encourage all of you who have even the slightest interest to run for town council. It's a wonderful experience. It is the best way to get to know your town. and to know the citizens of the town, and I think you'll find it also very rewarding.
I can only second all that you have said, ma'am. We are going to enjoy our retirement also. For those of you who, and a good segue too, for those of you who are interested and did not have a chance to watch a panel discussion that was presented on the cable channel last Tuesday night, I believe it was, we did conduct that discussion. It runs for about an hour, and I don't know if anybody else who was involved has a videotape. It's a discussion of municipal office, what it's really like to serve in that capacity. And we had representatives from both school board and from the town council there. I do happen to personally to have a copy of the tape of that evening, and anybody who would like to see it, if you cannot get it through a rerun on the cable channel, please get in touch with me. I'd be glad to share it with you. Some other announcements, just to let the public know what has been transpiring in the last month. On January 16th, the council did hold a daycare forum discussion. We had a very encouraging turnout and very wide-ranging, broad-based discussion relative to the daycare situation. We will be discussing the council's next actions on that later in this evening's agenda. On January 29th, the Cape Council and the Scarborough Council met together for dinner and had a very pleasant evening. We all thought it turned out well. I've had that same kind of feedback from at least one of the Scarborough councilors. It was a good way to get to know our peers in another community and to just have some informal discussion with them. We're also encouraging our school boards to have a similar kind of meeting together where they just get to know each other, and perhaps at some point in the not too distant future we can have both councils and school boards meet as a unified group. A couple of upcoming meetings I want the public to be aware of. On Monday, February 24th, we will be having a forum discussion about scenic areas. This is in relationship to the zoning ordinance rewrite process that is going on and will be soon coming up for a public hearing. There will be news of this in the next Cape Courier coming out this coming weekend, and we encourage anybody with any interest in the scenic vistas of the town to join us for that discussion. On Wednesday, March 5th, the council is scheduled for another workshop relative to that zoning ordinance rewrite, so we encourage people to join us that evening. That will be before the public hearing, which will be I expect scheduled later in May, in March. Have we already scheduled that? We have scheduled that. So at the March 12th meeting, which is on a Wednesday, we will be having the first public hearing on the zoning ordinance rewrite, but we certainly welcome input from the citizens at our workshop discussion on March 5th. And I think that is the end of my comments anyway. Is there anybody else who has additional comments, correspondence, reports? All right. We now have a time for citizens' discussion of items that are not on this evening's agenda. Is there anybody in the audience who would like to come to the microphone to take advantage of that? Seeing none, we will move on to our first. Pardon me? Councilor Reed, I'm sorry.
I don't know if this is the same one Councilor McGinty has. I'd like to know the process of requesting that the town council donate enough money for a cappuccino machine for the youth center. Not what Councilor McGinty was going to ask.
No, you had in mind, John. Do we
ask,
know what?
I'm sorry, ask the question again.
What is the process? I don't know. I mean, you asked for donations, and I want to know why we just don't donate it, since one of the things we want to do is make sure that this gets off the ground, and certainly as a not a capital expense, but it is an item that if the place closes, we can take back and use for staff.
Sounds like a good idea to me. They're kind of they don't give them away. I would suggest we would at least come up with half of it to start it off, and it could be leased and whatnot if we came up with half the money. And the gate would pay the rest. That would at least go for half, maybe more.
Councilor Jordan.
What is the cost of one of these rigs?
Well, they're over $1,000, but that seems to be the number one item that they would like to have there, and So I'd like to help them in some way. I certainly would like to, I think it'd be appropriate for them to work and to, I think like all of us, we take care of things better when we've had to work for them. And so I think that some combination perhaps of the town contribution would be fantastic.
Councilor Groff.
I hate to be the person who rains on someone else's parade, but I don't think it's business of the town council to unilaterally offer to provide anything to any group. There's lots of worthy groups in town without a specific plan, a request. We're just sort of pulling this out of the air. I think the time's going to come, and I'm a supporter of this whole concept, but I think we should do things on a more program basis. I don't think it's a good idea just to sit at a town council meeting and say this would be a nice thing to do and just do it. I think if there's a formal request and if there's understand, if there's information available as to how things are going for the public, and then there's a discussion with a longer-term plan about what involvement the council should have with this particular group, when there's a lot of other groups in town that also could very well use support, then that's a different discussion. But just to do this on an ad hoc basis like this, I mean, I would not be able to support that.
Let me say, if anybody is interested in formulating a plan for this, that would be appropriate and can bring it to the attention of the council. But I think, you know, it's not something that we're going to be able to take any action on this evening.
I asked for the process, so
we need some more information.
Well, I think what, Madam Chair?
Councilor Linnell?
Councilor McGinty and I are substance abuse, we're the key people with the substance abuse goal. We're working with the idea is to reduce substance abuse in the town.
Thank you for rewording that.
So I think we'll talk with that board and encourage them to bring a I certainly will encourage them to bring a proposal forward.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Jordan.
Well, I just want to, I don't know if I'm adding much to it, but after Councilor Groff made a statement that come to my mind that I would like to know. As Councilor Linnell said at one time, we can get part of it at the gate. I would like to know some figures, what we're talking, how much would possibly be at the gate, and whether the town should support it or not. I got to have more information, I'll put it that way.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, I'm not sure Councilor Reed's question was ever asked. Whatever proposal might come forward, any councilor could sponsor an item on the agenda, it could be sponsored by that subcommittee, and there just should be something received by the first of the month for the succeeding month's agenda.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything, Councilor McGinty?
Not on that issue, I had something else. Just a point of order, the approval of the meeting, minutes.
Minutes, thank you, sir, very much. And these are minutes of meeting number 13, which was held January 13, 1997, and of meeting number 14, which was held January 16, 1997. Can I have a motion for the minutes, please?
Move approval.
Thank you. Second?
Second.
All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. We have two public hearings scheduled on the agenda this evening. The first is a consideration of a proposed designation of the new bridge as the Casco Bay Bridge. The second is relative to proposed amendments to the Fort Williams Park Master Plan. For the proposed designation of the new bridge as Casco Bay Bridge, before I open up the public hearing, I would just like to comment that for me, this process was much more than naming, coming up with a name for a bridge. I found it a very heartwarming example of cooperation and collaboration between Portland, South Portland, and Cape Elizabeth. We had representatives from all three of those communities involved. They heard from the public of those three communities. They heard from citizens outside those three communities. From what I read about and in discussions with Gary Beckwith, who was the Cape Elizabeth representative on the committee, I understand they went through a very strenuous public process, for lack of a better word, perhaps. And I personally want to thank the committee, three members of which are here this evening, for taking part in this, giving your time and your energy, and helping to show that the three communities really can work together in something worthwhile. Thank you very much, gentlemen. And Gary, would you like to come to the podium and give us some input and insight, please?
Thank you, Chairman McLaughlin. I'm Gary Beckwith, 10 Oakwood Road. And on early in November, I received a call from our chairman asking if I would accept an appointment to this bridge naming committee. It took me a few hours to think it over and call back and said, yes, I would like to. And on November 26, we met as a committee here in Town Hall with the representatives and the council heads at that time from Portland, South Portland, and Cape Elizabeth. Two of the members, Art Tordoff from South Portland, is here tonight, and our chairman of the committee, Lee Urban from Portland, is here also with his son, both to fill in where I might miss out and to answer questions. But to make this fairly short, we did, I would call it not strenuous, but intense. A rather short order. It said in the newspaper yesterday when they were talking about the bridge up around Topsom that they wouldn't take as long. We did well. We worked, we had 8 meetings, and we finished our report the 13th of January and had the report to our chairman on the 14th of January, and we recommended the name, the Casco Bay Bridge. It was an interesting process. We worked by consensus, and with Lee Urban's chairmanship and organizational skills, it went rather quickly and rather well. We each took a turn taking minutes of each of our meetings, and they were open to the public. And in doing so, all but one meeting had members of the public in attendance. By December 30th, we had a list of names of 136 suggested names. From phone calls, letters, and just talking with people on the street, we had that list of names. Some of them, just for the fun of it, and I won't go over all of them, picking out the Bay View Bridge, which was one of them that sounded. Betty, this was an interesting one, the name Betty. Bridge. Edifying today, tomorrow, and yesterday. The Big Red Bridge, the Rivalry Bridge, the Bridge, Glory B Bridge, the Red Serpent, the Gazillion Dollar Bridge, the Puffin Bridge, and the blank blank bridge, profanity, but one person was very. Some of the input that we did receive was very serious. We had organized lobbying efforts for George Mitchell and George Cleves. Real strong lobbying, letter writing, hearing attended lobbying efforts. But for each of those that we heard, for specific names, I think individually, I'll speak for myself, for each name that I heard specifically, I heard other people say, please stay away from the name of a person. And some of them were very sincere requests. So At our last meeting, we had narrowed it down to five choices: the Casco Bay Bridge, the Citizens Memorial Bridge, Harbor Bridge, Mariners Bridge, and the Mariners Memorial Bridge. And from that point, we just had positive, negative comments from each of the committee members, and by consensus, we came to recommend to you the name Casco Bay Bridge for a number of reasons. It fits, perhaps not exactly geographically, but it fits in location. And as Arthur said, when you crest the new bridge and you look to the east, or you're going to have a magnificent view on good days. It does fit, and we recommend that you would approve of that name. A little bit of a follow-up. If this name passes muster and goes to the department, the Transportation Committee at the legislature, we would stand ready to to speak in behalf of this name at that point. So we heartily recommend that to you people. Now, may I take just a moment to go back to Oz? As you know, it was almost exactly a year ago that Chad Doody received a serious injury in an automobile accident, and he's made a member of our church. The Methodist Church has made a startlingly good recovery. And each of the last three Sundays that we have had the meeting of Oz, he has stood up proudly and given the numbers, and then proudly saying, and we had no incidences. All went well, and the church was in good shape for service the next morning. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Mr. Beckwith. Is there anybody from the audience who would like to speak to this item? One question I would have of the committee is, can you tell me which legislator is sponsoring the bill for this name?
Mike Saxel
from Portland. Right. Thank you very much. The process, as I understand it, and I'm sure I'll be corrected if I misspeak, is that once all three communities consider the name that has been proposed by the committee, then Mr. Saxel's bill will go to the Transportation Committee of the legislature. Presumably that will have a public hearing, and then that committee will report out to the full legislature. Is that okay? So at this point, both Portland and South Portland have taken a positive vote on the proposed name, and it just awaits this community having a vote, and then the committee will relay the results to Representative Saxel, and it'll go forward from there. Any discussion from the council? Do we have a motion, please? Councilor Linnell.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I move that we endorse the name Casco Bay Bridge.
A second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Resounding 7-0. Thank you very much for your work. Next item on the agenda is consideration of proposed amendments to Fort Williams Park Master Plan for a public hearing. Mr. McGovern, do you have an intro on this?
I wasn't planning on one.
Okay.
This has been before the Ordinance Committee, been before the Council for some time.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Jordan, is there anything you'd like to say prior to the public hearing comments?
No, I don't know. Before the hearing or not afterwards, but I will just point out that we have two policies here that is being recommended from the Ordinance Committee, that what it does, I'll read part of it in just a highlight. Existing buildings within the area may be maintained and enhanced, including but not limited to the restoration of the Goddard Mansion in gardens and maintenance of the civilian defense bunker and provision for a handicap accessibility and delivery areas. Existing lawns area shall continue to be maintained, and the wooded areas shall be managed according to the forestry management standards intended to preserve the forest. No construction shall be allowed except to establish pedestrian pathways and construction and enhancement of roadways. Now, this area I'm speaking of is, I would say best way to spell it out is, at the Surf Road area, going across along the waterfront, pertaining to the where the CD bunker is, and up by the flagpole and down towards the lighthouse. And those are some of the provisions that's in there as far as the Audit Committee and the Planning Board recommendations. Then Policy Statement 3 is existing buildings within this area may be maintained and enhanced. Use within the buildings shall be approved by the Town Council. Roadways and parking lots may be constructed and enhanced. No construction is allowed which is compatible with any and an activity recreational area, including but not limited to the public restrooms and recreational facilities. Informal and intensive recreation activities, such as but not limited to team sports, concerts, and public assemblies, shall be allowed with the advice of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. And that is the area from the lighthouse, I would say, the best way to put it, in my opinion, if unless I've got it wrong, and around towards Delano Park and what have you. And up by the buildings there and the old garages, as we're speaking of on that one. And that's the one that I have problems with because I am still disgusted that we have taken out and allowing for the Public Works Department to use an area in that area to have some materials to work on when they're in Cape Cottage, and also a place to dump snow in the wintertime. And therefore, I'm not going to support policy number 2 because I think it's wrong for us to sit here and try to save here and have problems with Shore Road and then put more traffic on it when you've got that acreage over there that we can't use, a couple of acres of it. And I'm very disappointed that the way the vote went. That's all I have to say on those two.
Thank you, Councillor Jordan. Is there anybody from the public who would like to speak to this? This is a public hearing on the proposed amendments, proposed policies. Seeing none, I would entertain a motion and then we can have discussion.
Councillor Cogsell. I move that we approve the Fort Williams policy statement number 2 and number 3 as revised, along with the definitions for active recreation area and dedicated natural area and the policy map with, if this is approved tonight, with the staff providing a updated map, annotated map of Fort Williams Park.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Is there discussion? Councillor Linnell?
Yes, I think there's certainly some compromise in here. However, I think Councillor Jordan brings up a good point, and I think it's a shame not to be able to dump some snow over there if we needed to. And it'll probably pass without my vote, but for that reason, I think I'll abstain. I won't vote in support of it. However, if someone wants to put that some language in so that we could dump some snow over there, I would be happy to vote in favor of it.
Councillor McGinty.
The Public Works Director, Bob Malley, attended at least one of our Ordinance Committee meetings and was asked point blank directly whether he could live with this policy vis-a-vis dumping snow there. and he said he could. And I just would remind this council that should there be a major snow emergency of some sort, we can always find a way around this to allow at least a temporary dumping of snow there if we need to do that on an emergency basis. So I will be supporting this if the Public Works Director doesn't feel it's a problem, then I can support this.
Councilor Linnell.
I guess I'd feel a little more comfortable if there was some language in there that said, on an emergency basis, we can dump snow there, because otherwise I'm afraid that there may be some sort of an uproar or something, having brought this up. I hate to go on assumptions, and so I'd like to, you know, I think it would be reasonable to put some sort of language in there.
Council.
Obviously, it's not going to happen. They're not going to be dumping snow there in the middle of a soccer game, so I don't think it would disrupt things there, but I think it would make sense.
Councilor Linnell, may I suggest that while we carry on some more discussion, we try drafting up some of that language?
Sure.
Okay, and you can propose it as an amendment if you're so inclined. Councilor Jordan.
No, I just want to say it isn't so much that, I guess I wasn't on the ball because I was going to ask for a motion to take two separately and then three, but I guess my Councilor Coggeshall is sharper than I am and got the motion in there, so that I got the vote for, I support number two and I support number three, but not as it is printed. And to me, the issue isn't so much as the place to dispose of stuff, whether it's one load or 100 loads, that you're sitting here and want to put traffic on a road that I guess a couple, 3 months ago was dangerous, hazardous, and we needed sidewalks and we needed this. And now we're sitting here voting to put more traffic on it. That's what bothers me.
Hey, Councilor Reed.
I'd like to give Councilor Linnell a hint about the language that I would like to support on this. In the sentence that begins, planned activities such as but not limited to fireworks, public safety exercises, emergency public works, and rock climbing.
Can you help me with what line you're on, please?
Yes, 24, beginning 25. With 25?
Yes.
And after a public safety exercise, comma, public works emergency. Emergency public works.
Madam Chairman?
Councilor Linnell.
I appreciate the help from Councilor Reed. I want to suggest, I think, what might be a little better place to put that, though. And right. The only reason I say it is because planned activities, emergency snow removal may be considered not exactly planned. I don't know. So I just thought we could just put it in, and I'm not married to this idea. I mean, whatever works. But I'm suggesting, having had just a couple seconds more to look at it, about line 21, before the sentence which begins informal recreation, because we're talking about no construction, enhancement of roadways and parking lots. I'm just suggesting that might be a better place. And the language I'd propose would be something like, the town may place snow in this area during a as needed, as necessary.
Councilor Graf.
I'm sorry for being a little dense, but when we say this area, where specifically in the fort are we talking about piling snow? I'm a little lost as to exactly what we're talking about. I'm not going to vote for anything unless somebody can tell me where it is in Fort Williams that we're going to make a snow a big snow pile that with salt and, you know, road ice and the whole business. So that's what I need to know.
Councilor Jordan, do you have a location in mind?
I had a location in mind, but the Fort Williams Committee rejected it, and I see no harm with it, and it's down. It's down towards the lighthouse, as you swing right there, just below the bunker, and you go over there before you get to the next bunker. And I think there's a field and an area that wouldn't bother anybody, and if somebody might see it from the lighthouse parking lot. I think it's a useful area, and there's another area that could be used up where the garages are, but I don't know if it's quite large enough. Depends on how much snow you get and how much you want to use it. But there's 90-odd acres there, and if we can't find 5 acres to do something like this in, I think it's a damn shame.
My concern, Councilor Jordan, is you're talking about the southern section of the fort, and I believe what you're talking about is between one of the batteries and the parking lot for the fort, for the museum and the rest of the fort. And that is not something that's not in the consideration of the two policies we have before us this evening, if I'm correct in my location.
I think number three does it.
No, it doesn't.
Number three is the active recreation area. Okay, were you having something on the uphill side?
Madam Chairman, do we have a better map we can look at? I mean, this is really... is there anything available?
Not.
This is the reason why in the draft motion it's requested that the staff develop an annotated map, so it'll be a lot easier for everyone to follow.
Councilor Graff?
Here's my problem. I thought last time we met that we had a vote and we did not allow, because of the history of this, what's happened in the southern section of the fort and a ball field and different groups, that we voted to not allow snow in the southern section of the fort, which I'm not saying that's a right decision or a wrong decision, but I thought we made that decision. And now it seemed to me, reading this, that we were zoning the other two areas of the fort, which I think is very appropriate. And that's why I was confused as to, and why I asked the question of where we're talking about a snow dump in either of these two other areas of the fort, because I didn't think either of these two policy statements had to do with the southern area of the fort, unless I'm just really missing something.
I think you're on target, sir. Okay, Councilor Linnell, is your potential amendment relative to either of the two areas under discussion this evening?
Well, I'm not sure. I find the map here really hard to read. Now, maybe it is, maybe it isn't, but...
Well, could you give us a location you have in mind, please?
Maybe
we can help.
I think what Councilor Jordan is talking about is down by the, towards the ocean there, by the bunker. Yeah.
Which is not one of the considerations tonight.
And that's not in here.
That's not on tonight's agenda.
Dedicated.
Yeah. If you're talking about the green, that's not under discussion this evening. In a minute.
Okay, I guess that's right.
That's in the southern section of the fort.
Yeah, that's the southern section. So, if it's in the southern section, I guess that's the end of that discussion. Right. Unfortunately.
All right. Councilor Cogsell?
What these two statements here basically are bringing together a lot of the recommendations that were in the master plan. And back in 1990, the council approved a permanent dedication of certain areas to be open space with certain kinds of restrictions. And part of that area is the active playing field that they have now for the Little League fields, and the soccer field and the parade field. So that's why the committee decided to have an active recreation area that is the whiter part of the map in our packet tonight, to allow everything that's going on in that area to continue, to allow in the future if bathrooms needed to be constructed, they would. Those are the areas that have been, through previous studies, determined to be the better areas. If we should ever have admission fee, somewhere in those general areas would be the collecting spot. So this is to just continue the previous dedication and recommendations in the master plan and to make it more appropriate to how it's being used today.
Thank you, Councilor Cogswell. I have a question. I'm wondering if any consideration was given to extending the proposed dedicated natural area, which would be policy number 2, to the south side of the main entrance road for the natural stand of trees that runs from the right side as you're going in of the main entrance road up the ridge to Wheatley Road. And you know, if anybody in the ordinance committee can remember dealing with that. It just seems peculiar to me, and I apologize for not having brought this up sooner, but every time, I think it's an instance of every time you look at something, you see something new. Mm. It seems, I'm perplexed why we're calling that active recreation as opposed to dedicated natural area. I'm at a loss to imagine what active recreation is going to happen there.
The active recreation area, this Wheatley Road section, is that fire station field.
I'm not talking about the field. I'm talking about...
You're talking about on the right-hand side of the drive going in, which mm-hmm. just through its topography is not suitable for much of anything at all.
Well, it's suitable for some things, but I would prefer they not be happening there.
What kind of thing would you...
Well, you could get someone who's bent on coming down there on rollerblades or something else equally exciting for some real active recreation. And I think it's more appropriate for that area to be part of the dedicated natural area. Councilor Groff?
Because of the topography of that area, I mean, I have no problem the way it's drawn, because all these policies don't automatically allow anything to happen there without going through the process, an extended process with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, and the town council would be able to review that again. And I think when we start at this level with this general master plan of trying to carve out little areas, all we're doing is, I think we're just going to have a very difficult time. I think this is a good compromise. It takes out broad areas. It doesn't mean that if one particular part of the area that can be developed allows development will be developed. I mean, that particular area you're talking about, I can't imagine what anybody would do with it. But if there was any wild scheme, it's not like it would automatically happen. I mean, we'd have this long review process. So I don't want this to be the only protection for the park. It seems to me what we're doing is trying to set out a general plan, but I wouldn't want the public to think that what we're doing tonight is the only protection for Fort Williams. I mean, this is just a baseline, and we're not shortcutting any procedures down the road that would have to be followed to develop anything. So we're not making development any easier here. We're in effect not helping change one iota, and I'm not saying we should help change. I mean, we're just creating these big natural areas, natural that have natural divisions, but the fact that one particular little area right now doesn't look it should be developed. I don't think that should be, that's not just cause in my mind to re-tamper with what they've done.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councilor Linnell?
I think the point's well taken. I think the topography, I think Councilor Groff makes a good point, that I think the topography is going to dramatically slow down any efforts to do anything, any organized sports or anything on that piece of land. So I would be tempted to go along with it as it is.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Mr. McGovern, you've been patient.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I just wanted to clarify on Councilor Jordan and Councilor Nell's questions about snow and where it might go and where you stand vis-a-vis policy. The green is a spot that was traditionally used, the big field next to Portland Headlight, for as a snow dump. That was dealt with by the council at an earlier meeting. The area where the ball field is going, that's shown over here, is another snow dump area. Obviously, that shouldn't be used because of what the salt would do to the ball field. The third area that's been occasionally used is the large open area up beyond the fire station, which is part of the active recreation area that you have before you this evening.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
I just want to say that nobody and I don't think anybody else, wanted to see the greens as a snow dump because of the materials that are brought in there. But when you go over there a little ways beyond the greens, there's an area as wide as this room and quite long that you could start backing in there and working out towards the road to do it. And I just feel if you leave the thing vague, they're going to haul it to the center of town and not care about the traffic. That's my concern.
Thank you. Councilor Cogsell?
Yes, I just want to emphasize to perhaps relieve your concerns about that particular area, that the forward towards the Shore Road area of that one strip shows on two separate maps land improvements. It's an erosion control area, and it's also a naturalized growth area, too, up by the street. Mm-hmm. So that's basically also protected as it already exists in the master plan.
Thank you. I was just trying to extend some
just wanted it colored
common
more.
Sense. Councilor Linnell.
I share Councilor Jordan's concerns. I guess I'm going to support this because basically I think we got beat last meeting, Bill. So I agree with you, but unfortunately, I think we got beat last time.
All right. Is there any further comment? Councilor Jordan.
I just a minute. Maybe you feel you got beat last meeting, and maybe I feel the same way, but I guess I'm going to get beat this meeting. I'll take it two at a time. And if I feel that to the taxpayers of this town that I can save a few bucks, I will work in that direction. If the rest don't care for that, that's okay. But that's the direction I'm working in.
Councilor Groff?
The last word I'll say on this is that I understand Councilor Linnell's concerns, Councilor Jordan's concerns. For better or for worse, that's not what we're voting on tonight on these two parcels. The two parcels that we're voting on has nothing to do with the southern section of the fort where the snow dump's been proposed. The two parcels we're voting on are the other middle of the fort and the side of the fort toward the mansion, and no one has proposed snow dumps there. And since no one has even proposed any snow dumps there, obviously that's just not for discussion tonight. If we want a snow dump in the southern section of the fort, that was voted on last time. Obviously, somehow that can be brought up again at some later time, and then we can address that issue. But that's not what's before us right now.
Okay. We do have a motion on the floor. Are there any questions on the content of the motion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 6-1. Thank you. Getting away from our public hearing items, we have item number 142. This is a consideration of report from the Planning Board regarding proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance and the zoning map relating to the setbacks for playing fields from a RP1 wetland and consideration of other amendments to the wetland section of the ordinance. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, this was earlier discussed by the Ordinance Committee. Then ultimately came back to the council, went to the Planning Board. The Planning Board has reported back a number of recommendations. If you have particular questions on it, Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, is here, ready to respond.
And I would just remind the council that you received at your seat this evening a map showing the wetland edge situation around Great Pond as an attachment to the memo that we received from the Planning Board. Councilor Jordan.
No, I would just like to ask the town planner, Mara, Marina Mara to say a few words in defense of this.
Maybe an explanation, anyway. Thank you, Ms. Amira.
Perhaps what I can do is just briefly go over the changes. I don't know how many of you are familiar with this, but these were a set of revisions that were directed to the from the town council to the ordinance committee. The ordinance committee wrote up the changes. They then forwarded back to the council as a zoning amendment. It has to be forwarded to the planning board. The planning board made basically three changes other than some punctuation. And what I'd like to do, unless anyone has any questions, is just to go over the changes made by the planning board. Starting on page 1, line 18, it's item number 2. One of the things that was pushing this whole set of amendments was the need to reduce the buffer for playing fields in order to facilitate the construction of the ball field at Lyons Field. The ordinance committee took an approach where the buffer would be reduced and that the ball field would fall outside the buffer and there would be no review of it except as a site plan. The planning board was concerned that because something is being constructed that close to a wetland, that there was a need for review, careful review of things like erosion control, stormwater design, use of best management practices. And so they restructured it so it does, you get to the same place, it's just a little different approach, where it leaves the ball field in the buffer and you need to get a special permit from the planning board. And that way you don't have to set up a whole bunch of special performance criteria for ball fields. You can just rely on the standards for a wetlands permit to make sure those erosion control, stormwater issues are addressed. Starting on the bottom of, on the bottom of page 1, starting on line 37, this is an existing standard that talks about topographical changes. What was attempted here was just to make it clearer. It's the exact same meaning that it's supposed to have right now, and I'll move on unless someone has a question about that. Starting on the bottom of page 2, line 36, a whole new section has been added. What was attempted here was there have been continuing concerns about the restrictions on homeowners of existing homes in wetland buffers, and there are provisions in the ordinance right now that allow those non-conforming structures to expand. There was concern that perhaps there should be more opportunities for them to expand. So in addition to the current provisions, a new provision was proposed that says if you have a non-conforming structure in an RP1 wetland buffer and your structure is at least 100 feet away, that means you're within the 250-foot buffer, but you're at least 100 feet away, a bubble gets formed around your house, and you can expand 50 feet in any direction. And you can do that as long as you meet certain standards. One, you don't get any closer than 100 feet to the wetland buffer. And two, that you don't expand your structure more than 25% of the floor area. One of the things the planning board did is that when this was recommended to them by the ordinance committee and the council, the basis for the limit on the expansion hadn't been decided. You had both floor area of the structure and building footprint and asked the planning board to make a decision. They chose floor area of the structure because that's what you normally use in other places. The third thing I should point out is on page 3, starting on line 20, there is existing language in the ordinance that requires people to have a deck that has a permeable surface and that the area underneath the deck is also permeable. The planning board took that language out. If you're going to build a deck, you might as well just build a deck.
Thank you. Are there any questions for Ms. O'Meara? Councilor Linnell.
Thank you. As I understand it, the new language that was added, it's just for the expansion of an existing building?
Starting on page 2?
Right.
Right. That whole section only deals with existing structures that are non-conforming because they sit either in a critical wetland or in a wetland buffer.
Okay. I might want some help later on. So you'll be here a little while. We have another question?
Sure.
Thanks.
Any other questions at this time? Councilor Reed.
Maureen, I'd just like a definition of official playing fields.
There is no specific definition.
Is that problematic?
I don't think it is. I think the word official is in there so that if a couple of kids gather and start playing on a relatively flat surface, you don't call it an official playing field. It's just place where people came together.
Thank you.
Anybody else at this time? Okay. Thank you very much.
Oh,
Councilor Groff, don't leave.
What, based upon your expertise in this matter and the Lions Field plan at this point in time, if in fact the Planning Board's amendments are affirmatively voted on, is the drainage of that field, how you would have to drain that field, affected? I mean, would it change the what would have to be done to construct the field or not, compared to the way the ordinance was drafted before?
I don't think there'd be any change in the way the field is designed. I think there might be a little bit more careful scrutiny of what is done with the water. For example, you've got obviously drainage coming off in this corner, and you would normally look at that and make sure you weren't washing out your road. I know with this plan that the 100-foot buffer runs right in through here, so this parking lot is something you're going to be looking at. And again, there's always drainage off of a parking lot. You'd want to make sure that you've got the appropriate amount of vegetation that's going to direct that flow and not erode a wetland. You're going to be looking at vegetating it so that you're not having a lot of sediment filling in the wetland. Those are the kind of things you'd be looking at, and really those are the kind of things you ought to be doing anyway.
So you do not believe that concerning that particular field, if in fact the field was being constructed properly, whether we approve the Planning Board's amendments or the original ordinance, it really shouldn't have much effect?
No.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Jordan, did you have a question?
Yeah, I'd just like to ask Maureen a question as far as on page 125, lift the mandatory 250 wetland buffer around portions of Great Pond. Shouldn't that be spelled out there somewhere or referred to something?
The map that I handed out tonight, which should have been attached to your packet,
yeah.
And I apologize for it being left out, is a photocopy of the zoning map. And when you adopt the zoning ordinance, you also adopt the zoning map, and they both are official documents that state the policy of the town. You can see how the area that I have tried to highlight in purple is a very heavy line. What will happen if you adopt item number 3 here is that will go from being a heavy line to a narrow line. And the zoning map legend in the bottom corner says that if it's a heavy line, it's a 250-foot buffer. So if it's not a heavy line, it's not a mandatory 250-foot buffer. So in effect, you it is in writing.
Okay.
Anybody else at this time? Thank you very much. As the manager has indicated in the summary of recommendations that we receive, it would be customary to refer this item to the Ordinance Committee. This item has been through the Ordinance Committee and then gone to the Planning Board. It may be that the Council wishes to consider having this item be one of the components of the public hearing next month rather than sending it back to the Ordinance Committee. It's just something that was in the recommendations for consideration.
I agree with that.
You speaking in your capacity as chairman of the Ordinance Committee?
Whatever you want to call it. Whatever you want to call me. I just say I agree in that direction.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Cogsell.
Are the sites that we have before us tonight the ones for the current ordinance or the ones for the Zork report? I didn't check this myself, I'm sorry.
It's a good question. And I think one of the reasons I was asked here tonight is the manager wanted me to lower the boom on noticing for the draft ordinance. The proposal you have in front of you tonight is amendments to the current ordinance.
Okay.
I cannot more strenuously emphasize the problems that we are running into with trying to amend an existing ordinance 30 days before you are considering a proposed ordinance. We have the Yellow Book, which is the proposed ordinance, that does not have in it the Fort Williams amendments that you adopted last month. So the first thing I need to do is I need to get the Fort Williams amendments into the new ordinance that you've adopted into the old ordinance, assuming that if you adopted them last month, you really are interested in seeing them in your new ordinance. What you have, yeah. So, and what you have...
Another crack at that, Bill.
Please.
That's a policy, you know. So what you have tonight is a proposal to amend your existing ordinance. What you may want to do instead is direct staff to take what is in your hand and incorporate it into the new zoning draft so that at least you're looking at one complete draft next month.
Next month would seem to be almost two ways to deal with this, if I'm following this correctly, to deal with it as an amendment to the current ordinance, which could be voted on next month on its own merits, and then to also draft it as a portion of the zoning ordinance rewrite that will have its first public hearing next month. Is that,
yes.
Mr. McGovern?
My preference would be twofold. One is what is in the notes that you recommend. It's recommended you ask the staff to include language to be compatible with the new proposed ordinance and to include this language as part of your public hearing next month. So therefore, it would get into the track for the new ordinance.
Right.
I also have a concern that the new ordinance will not become effective until likely on June 10th, 11th, 12th, whatever the date is, if assuming it's adopted in May. Mm-hmm. We really would like to get before the planning board prior to that time so we could entertain some construction during this construction season. So my encouragement would be for you to do a double track. Mm-hmm. One is to amend the old so we have standing before the board, and two is to ask the staff to incorporate some new language as well so that it could become part of the public hearing for the proposed new zoning ordinance.
So this could be part of two separate public hearings next month, if I'm correct.
Correct.
I just want to make sure
it would,
I know what I'm talking
only
about.
Only be in place for a month or two, but that month or two would give us the standing to get before the board.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Coxall.
And there also is another factor, because this was part of our overall wetlands ordinance that we had to have state approval for.
Right.
At least we could get this part of the ordinance in that 45-day review period if we do the two full track, mm-hmm. having this is a separate public hearing under these sites, and then having it included so it fits into the new ZORC report as part of that public hearing next month. I'm afraid we're just going to get terribly delayed if we just try to do it all in ZORC.
Would you like to draft that as a motion, Councillor?
I move that we set for public hearing the proposed wetland ordinance changes, section 192082, 193903, as proposed tonight. I hope those are all the right ones. 193912. For a public hearing Wednesday, March 12th, 7:30 p.m. in the Town Hall, and that we, as part of the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee, have the same language in the proper format as part of the ZORC public hearing Wednesday, March 12th at 7:30 p.m.
Thank you.
And the accompanying map.
Second.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. This motion puts this into a two-track scenario. Councilor Linnell.
Yeah, I just have, I guess, really basically one or two comments. When the staff is looking at this, I would like to see an option in here to just, we're going to shorten up the wetland buffer. I'd like to see it just 100 feet, period. And the reason for that, whether it's a playing field or whatever you want to do, because I for a long time, the town has been very, you know, sort of a real stickler on wetland issues. And I think it's kind of inconsistent if we, having turned down a lot of people on a lot of projects, if we don't make this available across the board. So I'd like to, if I can...
You can have the council direct staff, but you can't direct staff.
All right. Well, I'd like to see that anyway. I just think it's, we need to be consistent here. And if we're going to make an exception, I don't think that's quite fair. I think it should be for everything, for everyone, for everything. Yeah. Not just official playing fields, not just for fields, but for other construction or whatever people want to do with their property.
I want to make sure I understand correctly that you would totally eliminate the 250-foot buffer everywhere in town, and where that is in place, you would substitute a 100-foot buffer. Is that correct?
Yes.
And you are making a comment that we have turned down a significant number of development proposals because of the 250-foot. Do you have some numbers to back that up?
No, I just, there's just a, it's sort of an osmosis. I mean, I've heard a lot of concerns that people have about, well, you can't do this or that because of this wetland buffer. And so I just think that if we're going to make an exception, I just think we should be, in fairness, we ought to do it everywhere.
Okay, my concern is that you're making such a sweeping statement, and I don't know how based it is in reality with the... if there's been a comparison done between a 100 and a 250-foot buffer. My concern is that statements like that get made, they're heard by the public, and they people automatically believe them. I don't know one way or the other, so...
If you read just,
that should be a different...
And if I could ask Ms. O'Meara to come back and remind us if there are any state requirements for the 250-foot buffer, first of all.
The buffer that you're reducing right now is a very small portion around Great Pond, and you are required as a town to comply with the state's mandatory shoreline zoning. If you think of shoreline zoning as more than just short zoning along the edge of the water, but a whole package of environmental zoning requirements that govern not just setbacks from the ocean, but also setbacks from rivers, setbacks from wetlands, setbacks in floodplain areas. One of the requirements was that if you have a wetland that has been rated moderate or high value by the Department of Inland Fisheries and Wildlife, then you are required to take a strip 250 feet wide around that wetland and zone it resource protection. Because the town of Cape Elizabeth already had local zoning as one of a handful of communities in the state that has that, we appealed to the state for special local status. We did not want to take our area and zone it resource protection because we had just started getting comfortable with the idea of the wetland buffer. And everyone was starting to understand that the wetland buffer extended from the wetland upland edge up 250 feet. If we had to take certain wetlands in town and now say, well, except for this wetland where the wetland edge is not where the edge of the wetland zone is in the RP zone, now you have to go 250 feet further. But it's only three wetlands in town that applies, and the rest of them you do it another way. You can see how the confusion started to come across. Yeah, that look. So what we said is we will not zone it resource protection, but it is part of our critical wetland buffer, and our buffer is just as restrictive as your resource protection requirements. Therefore, the way we're going to write our ordinance is we're going to say in these three areas, these three wetlands, the buffer cannot be reduced. So it's a trade-off with the state. The reason that we're proposing this one change in this one area of Great Pond is they do allow you to argue that in densely developed areas you can make an argument that it's not an area that you need to zone resource protection. So I went around the edge of Great Pond and I measured, and there were at least two structures per 1,000 linear feet, and that should meet the state's criteria for being densely developed. That's why that one small section of Great Pond is identified as not a mandatory buffer. There still would be a 250-foot buffer there, but people on a case-by-case basis could apply to have the buffer reduced. There are a few people that might help. I suspect there aren't going to be a lot of people because they're closer than 75 feet from the wetland edge, and the state just says you cannot do certain things if you're that close to the wetland. So there are requirements that talk about 250 feet. I would like to, I've been privileged to sit in many, many, many ordinance committee meetings, and I feel I should share with you at this one time that this issue has been raised over the years many times. In 1992, the whole idea of the 250-foot buffer was raised. Information was provided to the entire council about what types of wildlife need to have what width of buffer in order to survive. And it was decided at that time that they would leave the 250 feet and just provide some relief for people that already had structures in those areas. As recently as a few months ago, the Ordinance Committee again was asked point blank, why are we keeping the 250-foot buffer? Why don't we just go with 100 feet? And my sense, and I will leave it up to the Ordinance Committee members to correct me if I'm wrong, but the sense I got was that there was no desire to allow a reduction in the 250-foot buffer for new development. That there was a great feeling of sympathy for people that already had structures in the buffer, and that's why the efforts have always been put into allowing expansion of non-conforming structures. But there was no desire to reduce the width of the buffer for new development.
Thank you for the background. Is there any other councillor who would like to speak in support of Councillor Linnell's proposal? Councillor Jordan?
I'd just like to correct the town planner that I think there's one member of that committee that didn't agree with that, that they would like to see it reduced. Am I correct?
That's right.
Thank you.
Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this issue? Okay, seeing none. We do have a motion on the floor. Is there any further comment on the motion? All right, all those in favor? All those opposed? 6-1. Thank you very much. Next item on the agenda is consideration of a report from the Pool Study Committee. This report recommends repairs to the pool as soon as possible and the creation of a pool building committee for more extensive repairs and update of the pool and related facilities. The council also does have a draft charge for a pool building committee. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, we have two of the three pool committee members here this evening, Gail Dransfield, the committee chairman, and Rosemary Reed, a member of the council. Did you want to comment on this? Would you like me to move forward? Okay. The committee met following your meeting with your joint workshop on January 7th and determined that there are a number of items which should be pursued immediately because they relate to life safety issues, as well as one that's a very important testing issue. They include some additional smoke and fire detectors, replacing some of the interior piping of the pool with PVC, upgrade the emergency lighting, which is less than adequate, fire alarms in the pools and in the pool and in the locker areas, and testing of the pool deck, as well as contingency and engineering. The estimate for each of these is $38,500, including contingency, and it's recommended that you fund that out of undesignated surplus. The committee also recommended, it's not specifically before you this evening, it's recommended that the pool project and operation of the pool after any construction be a municipal responsibility and not a school department responsibility. That's a proposal that, you know, had very strong support from the committee. It does need more work in defining some of those issues and working out, but there's a very, very strong measure of support for that from the committee. Finally, it was recommended to create a building committee, and there's a draft charge here before you. One of the issues which Councilor Gogzal raised with me today is, I think, very significant, and that it is a lot of money to come up with the funds for this pool committee to work with, and should that be considered as part of the budget of this evening. And I would defer to the council on that issue. But I would strongly support the emergency repairs that need to be made with the funds to come from the town's undesignated surplus, with the understanding that would be moving toward creating a building committee, and, you know, perhaps the council wishes to do that now or wait till the budget process.
Thank you. Any questions for the manager at this point? Could we have a motion, please? Councillor Reid.
Madam Chairman, I move that we approve the emergency repairs as stated in the memo.
With an expenditure of up to?
Yes.
38.5.
Thank you.
Second.
Any discussion?
Do you want it to say to be taken from undesignated surplus?
That would be helpful.
Yeah, it should be nice.
Second.
The second agree to that?
Yes.
Whoever over there second.
I don't know who she wrote down, but we all agree.
Phyllis's last term.
Oh, aren't you generous?
I'm going to call this the first part of this item on the agenda so we can have further discussion about the potential draft for the responsibilities for a building committee. All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion on that motion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Okay, for part B, proposed charge to the building committee is that a pool building committee is hereby created, shall consist of a town council member and a school board member, each to be chosen by the chairs of their respective bodies, a member of the Community Services Advisory Commission jointly chosen by the chairs of the town council and the school board. In addition, four citizens shall be chosen to serve by the town council upon recommendation from its appointments committee. The town manager, the principal of the Cape Elizabeth High School, and the director of community services or the designees shall be non-voting ex officio members of the committee. Committee purpose, committee shall develop a specific proposal to renovate and improve the Donald Richards Pool, including any desired modifications to the pool wing of the Cape Elizabeth High School. The proposal shall be submitted to the town council no later than December 31, 1997, with an earlier date preferred. The committee shall also assemble information on the extent of pool use and shall consider the effects of any pool construction program on programs and activities housed at the pool. Committee budget. The committee shall have available an appropriation of $50,000 from undesignated surplus for architectural and engineering services and for other expenses. The town manager shall approve the hiring of any consultant and the expenditure of any funds.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion on the draft proposal. Councillor Groff.
How was the $50,000 amount arrived at?
Mr. McGovern?
It was, I had asked Harriman and Associates for a specific proposal that I anticipated coming in prior to this evening. It has not arrived. That amount was raised at by the standard construction schedules put out by the Bureau of General Services as to a project of this approximate level and what it's assumed it would cost. This would not be all the engineering fees and costs throughout the whole proposal, but it's my sense that it would be enough to get us to the point of final design. It wouldn't include construction management or that aspect of the project.
Councilor Coxall?
It's Councilor Groff. Are you thinking about it?
Go ahead.
All right.
I think slowly sometimes.
No, I'll just reiterate what I had said to the manager, and he passed on to you, that we are so close to the budget process. While I believe there is a definite need for this committee, and I have no trouble with the composition, I do have a problem with our constantly dipping into undesignated surplus. So far, we've allocated over $235,000 out of the budget process that we've taken out of undesignated surplus. And as the manager said, he's not even sure if that is enough for this committee to complete their report. I think that it's not the best way to handle our money to just keep dipping into undesignated surplus.
Councilor Groff.
I understand what Councilor Coggeshall is saying, but what is the alternative? I guess that's why I paused, because if in fact, from at least based upon my understanding of our joint meeting, if we do nothing, we have the distinct possibility of a pool deck collapsing. We have the possibility in the short run, and when I say short run, within a year or so, of having a totally unusable pool. And unless we move forward now and start this process, don't we run the risk of having a major town asset that will become unusable for the populace? And if there's another option that you're proposing, I'm willing to listen to it, but I just don't understand what option B is yet, I guess.
Well, I guess the testing funds for testing have already been allocated. We just did that. And perhaps Rosemary or Gail could explain. I'm not sure exactly what the time frame is. I'm talking about a general policy of just constantly dipping into undesignated funds.
Well, I understand that. I just still don't understand what
it's always a crisis when we do it, so I just thought, Rosemary.
Do you want me to go with it? One of the discussions we had at the last meeting, which was attended by the chairs of the town council and the school board, was the time frame and what needs to be done when, whether or not this does become a referendum issue or not. And one of the issues that we have is a very tight time frame, which is why it would could, in fact, hurt the project and increase the cost if we were to wait for another budget cycle. The good news is there is the money available in the undesignated surplus right now. As Councilor Groff mentioned, we're looking at a $3 million asset that we really have taken very little time to evaluate, and we have to make these repairs, and this will certainly give us a plan. And we have to decide if a possibility is a probability of collapse. Not that I want to scare anybody, I certainly don't, but right now we just don't have that information, and we need it before we go forward. And it'd also be very important for some of the recommendations that have to be made to the town council within the following year.
Councilor Linnell.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Certainly we have a responsibility to manage our money and so forth. I think in this particular instance, however, I mean, if my truck were in as bad a shape as that pool, and despite what you may have seen, it isn't, and I had a similar proportionate amount of money in the bank, I think I would go and get it fixed. So I think there's a compelling need to get started on this.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
I'm not against moving forward. I'd just like to know more of the schedule. When and what it's and how it's going to affect the pool as far as being used. Is there any schedule out to that effect as far as the renovations? Is it going to be shut down here in a month? What's going to happen? How's it going to work?
Mr. McGovern?
The indication was that all of the emergency repairs the council just passed would probably get underway about a month from now, by the time you get all the materials and get it installed. There may be interruptions on a day here or a day there, but it wouldn't affect the overall operation of the pool. The longer-term project, it is expected that it would close the pool for a considerable period of time. It is still undetermined as to what the length of that time would be, as well as the exact timing of it. I think the discussion in the sense is that it would probably come after the next interscholastic season.
Okay, thank you.
I shared Councillor Cogsill's concern that we do tend to, or at least we seem to tend to go to our undesignated surplus quite often. However, when we were working on the current year's budget, we did not have the report from the pool study committee. I, for one, did not know the severity of the problem, was not aware of the severity of the problems there. And that's why I can be supportive of this kind of expenditure, knowing the hard work we have done over the years to build up the undesignated surplus. And I see that as an emergency account. And that's why I feel that I can justify this kind of expenditure at this time. Anybody else? Any further comment? Councilor Cogsill.
Well, I thank Councilor Reed for filling us in on the time frame, but I just thought it was important for the general public to know the overall picture and the way some of the things are being done. We are moving along just by allocating those emergency funds.
Right.
It would be, I feel more comfortable if we had a better idea of what the committee budget would be than just your taking a few figures out of a construction book.
Councilor Linnell.
Well, I think what we'd try to do on appointments committee is find people that have some fiscal responsibility, and perhaps they would ultimately shape some of that.
Councilor Groff.
I appreciate Councilor Coggeshall's concerns about the undesignated surplus. I also appreciate the fact that we don't have a good handle on what this study will cost. I will, however, support this based upon the fact that the proposal for this $50,000 does not say that this $50,000 will be spent. The proposal says the town manager shall approve the hiring of any consultant and the expenditure of any funds. I think it's clear that the town manager understands the concern of this council that expenditures be kept to a minimum, and I have every confidence that the town manager will only authorize that portion of the $50,000 which he, after consultation with the council, believes in the best interest of the town. And for that reason, I'm willing to support this.
Any further comment?
Move the question.
All those in favor of moving the question? Right. This is in favor of taking a vote on the, in favor of moving the question and cutting off discussion. All those in favor of that, doing that?
Is there a motion?
There is a motion, and it was seconded. Mm-hmm. All right. Could I have the vote again on moving the question? There seemed to be
to
some
move the
confusion.
Question to vote.
Vote to move the question.
To vote.
To vote.
One, two,
to vote.
Three.
That's what the that's
right.
What they're moving.
Okay. All those opposed to moving the question. I saw 6-1. All right. We do have a motion. The motion was, as I read the draft of the pool building committee response creation purpose and budget. It was seconded. All those in favor of that motion? 7-0. Thank you. I would ask that any counselor who is interested in serving on that committee, please let me know within the next 2 weeks. Thank you very much. Councilor Reid.
Madam Chairman, is it appropriate to ask that applications for the at-large four citizens be in the town hall before the 5th of March at this time?
I'm going to look at the calendar to see when we could advertise that in the Cape Courier. I think the earliest we could advertise it in the Courier is March 1st, which makes that rather tight. So I think if you might want to revise that.
Okay.
All right. Which would bring it to for approval to the council in April, at the April meeting. Okay, thank you. I just need to make a note. Item number 144 is consideration of a request from the Coalition for Equitable School Funding for a membership donation of $2 per student, which in our case would equal $3,582 for 1997 membership. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, we've contributed money in the past to this particular group. I would like you to note on the October 1996 summary of what they're about and what they're urging the state legislature to do. Three things, including a cost of living adjustment and the property value side of the distribution formula. That's something helpful to Cape Elizabeth. Two, increasing the per pupil operating rate to accurately reflect total operating expenditures in the operating allocation formula. That has mixed value to Cape Elizabeth. Number three, increasing the weight of income in the general purpose aid formula as a measure of ability to pay. That, as we've seen this past year, is extremely detrimental to Cape Elizabeth. The request is before you.
Madam Chair.
Councilor Linnell.
We have a member of the school board here. I just wondered if, Gail, if you have you had a chance to think about this? Because I talked to the superintendent today, and I didn't know if there's...
Dr. Bowles called me before I came this evening because she knew I was going to be here for the pool study. And ask that I urge you to vote against this because the school funding formula, income-based school funding formula, has brought us to a crisis in our budget with $300,000 in deficit because we reduced school funding to that amount. And she also felt that we have been somewhat misled by the proposal that we were not very well served. And I really am not very informed on this.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank
all
you
I need
much.
To know.
Do I have a motion to table this indefinitely?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you.
Took care of it pretty fast.
Item number 145 is consideration of the next steps following our recent forum on daycare issues. And I noticed that the comment on the suggested summary of recommendations was the council chairman would have a recommendation.
That's right.
Yeah, actually, I do.
For what?
Man, I just announced he's deserting his seat. We did have our daycare forum in January. We heard input from a number of residents, a number of daycare providers, a number of daycare users, a number of citizens who have daycare operations in their neighborhoods. What I need to hear from the council tonight is how you want to proceed with this, if you feel more information is needed, if so, what kind of information. I would then propose that we consider sending any specific recommendations to the ordinance committee, or even any general recommendations to the ordinance committee for their work in drafting up something for planning board and council consideration. Our typical process, as we've stated before this evening, is for something to go to the ordinance committee, for the work of that committee then to be passed along to the planning board for public hearing, and then come back to the town council. This is all if councilors are, if the majority of the council feels that they want amendments made to the existing ordinances relative to daycare situations. If they feel no ordinance amendments are needed, then the ordinance committee does not have to deal with this. But we need to know where the council stands on this. Councilor McGinty?
Is this something that we need to talk about at a workshop before we direct it to the ordinance committee? As a member of the ordinance committee, I'm not sure I would feel comfortable knowing what the direction of the town council is, not having sat down and discussed this amongst ourselves at a workshop, determine what we want to do, if we want to do anything, and what we want to do.
I didn't know if we could have some of that discussion this evening, or if we need, I mean, our workshop schedule is quite full between now and May at this point. We'll be going into budget sessions in April, and we already have two workshops scheduled in March and one in February. Councilor Jordan.
I would just like to say I didn't get much out of that meeting that we had with the public and the daycare people, that we had a problem. Now, I've talked to my grandson goes to a daycare now, and I have talked to each one of them, and they don't understand the problem as far as what they have to do. I didn't get into the issues of the ones that were against it, what they had to do, what we could do, and they're in Elizabeth Park, and they back up to other people's dooryard. I asked them, do you have problems with your neighbors? Do they complain about these youngsters out here running around? They're gonna make noise and what have you? And they said no. They seen it. So I just don't understand what the ordinance committee can do unless somebody wants to throw something in front of us to look at. Then I think, as Councilor McGinty says, it probably should be workshopped a little bit with the whole council to decide what direction you'd like to send the ordinance committee in. But as of now and the way things are, nobody's come to me and said anything that I can see or they could throw out to me, could we improve it? And I asked that question, how would you like to see a change made to improve the daycares the way they are set up now? So that's my point.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Reid?
I agree. I'd like to have a workshop on this, even though our schedule's full.
Anybody else? Councillor Linnell?
Sounds like a good idea, even though our schedule's full.
Thank you. Sounds like a June workshop. Councilor Jordan.
Good idea.
Sorry.
I'll go with the workshop.
I'll second.
I go with the workshop, but I hope somebody will come forward of where they can see something, whether we should change or do something to make it better. Just to have a workshop the way it is, I can't see it.
All right. I'm going to call you counselor, and I will not do that, Mr. McGovern.
There was some kidding from departing counselors about a June workshop, but from the point of view of staff, who will be dealing with many, many questions over the next month on contract zoning, on scenic views, on zoning issues, as well as on the paper street study, which you've also set a workshop, I would encourage you, if you want to pursue this issue aggressively, to put it towards June rather than in the shorter term.
Thank you.
Councilor Cogswell.
No, I agree with Councilor Jordan. I did not get any really additional constructive comments from that forum. The only message I sort of got was that there was some confusion on some applicants as to realizing whether or not they could do it immediately or if they should be cautious and talk to other people and wait 30 days before they expend their money. And perhaps just the code enforcement office could emphasize that extra heavily in the future if anyone comes in and applies. And that was about the only impression that I got, that the standards are not unreasonable, that the process has been lightened unless there is a complaint. Mm-hmm. And it seems to have worked fairly well over the years.
Councilor Groff.
I'm not disagreeing, but the concern, it seems the crux of the issue, is if you're an official in this town, what impact neighbors complaining about a proposed limited daycare of under six children, what impact that should have on the decision of whether to allow the daycare operator to have less than six children. And obviously, and we heard for the public that wasn't here about a situation that that some neighbors complained, and the board reviewing it took very seriously the complaints. And there's a question in my mind of, if I was on that board, what should I do? I mean, is it, if there's 10 neighbors complaining, does that give a prima facie, well, there shouldn't be a daycare center here, or is it traffic, or? And I thought it was tough because I didn't think there was a lot of guidance for the board members in how to govern their actions. And I think if we're going to talk about anything, that's really the crux of the issue, is whether they're going to look at specific criteria or whether it's just going to be what weight just generalized objections of neighbors are going to have in making decisions of that nature. And I'm not so sure I'd support any change. I think we, just so the public at large knows, I think we have a pretty pro child care, child center policy here in Cape Elizabeth. I mean, we're certainly, this town council, or I don't think anybody in the town is against child care. The question is whether it can be improved to a degree, and I don't know the answer to that. So if we are going to have a discussion about that, I think there's, since it's not totally broken at this point and we have other things that have priority over this issue, I think we could not spend a whole night on this, but if we're having, as we're stacking these things up, and perhaps I know we'll end up with some workshops in June, this could be one of those items that we have at a workshop, combining it with, by that time, I'm sure there's going to be need for some other workshop, and do it in June. And at least then everybody will have an opportunity to talk about it a little bit, and maybe nothing will come out of it, but it certainly doesn't have the same priority as some of the other things that we have to accomplish very quickly.
In summation, what I'm hearing is it's not terribly broken. It does not need a quick fix. It's appropriate to have this dealt with in a future council workshop. I would encourage the council to consider at that workshop inviting members of the Planning Board and the Zoning Board who deal with these issues and get some insight from them and maybe get some education from those two boards as well. So I would entertain a motion that this be set to a later workshop.
So moved.
Second.
Any further comment?
Just that if we have the opportunity to do it before June, we will do it. I mean,
yes.
We're not saying June at the next
right.
opportunity when it's...
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Great. Anybody else? Councilor Reed?
I just had a quick comment. One of the things that I learned at that meeting was the waiting list of 30 people for the community services program, and perhaps during budget, one of the issues that we'll be discussing is an expansion of the daycare after school program at community services, and if we could keep those comments in mind, I think it would be appropriate.
Very good. Thank you. Anybody else? All those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 146 is to consider authorizing a quitclaim deed for 8 Rosewood Drive. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, I would like to thank Deborah Lane for her work, not only on this, but on the entire tax collection process this past year. You know, you have a few of these come before you, but you have no idea what she goes through to get them to this point sometime. I'm appreciative of all of her work in this area and appreciative of this taxpayer as well as come forward and paid all their taxes in full, and would urge you to approve the quitclaim and authorize me to sign it on your behalf.
Thank you. Like a motion?
So moved.
Thank you.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 147 is to consider the status of lot U43-17C at 11 Park Circle. Mr. McGovern, you're fanning through all the correspondence.
This particular issue is one that is far, far more complicated. It was involved in a foreclosure proceeding. It was involved with Maine Savings Bank, was involved with recall. It had 13 creditors altogether. There was a question of whether or not we had notified all the proper owners. We had the town attorney's office through Beth Beaudry-Stilfen, paralegal, they do extensive research on exactly who had attachments, liens on the property. It ultimately was discovered that there were attachments equaling over $60,000 on it. Deborah Lane sent out notices to all of the parties with an interest. They had a 30-day period within which to notify and to pay up. None of them did so. That meant that we automatically foreclosed on the property earlier this year. The standard procedure would be, as long as the previous property owner came forward and paid up, you might quit claiming back to them. I feel it's inappropriate in this instance because it's only by virtue of the towns going through this whole process that the other attachments on the property were cleared. We in essence created the wiping out everyone else's attachments, which I think is a proper exercise of municipal responsibility to collect our taxes. I would suggest that we, in the interests of you know, some of the earlier discussion this evening, watching out for the town's purse strings, that we recognize the asset that we now have, that we go through a process to quiet the title to be sure that our foreclosure is in fact perfected, and to give people confidence as they would acquire the property, and that we move forward with that quieting title process, and to authorize us to begin the process of selling the property thereafter at fair market value.
Thank you. Like a motion? Okay. Councilor Graf?
So moved.
Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Thank you.
Moving along.
Thank you. Councilor Linnell?
Oh, well, I was just wondering, it's a kind of a nice exercise for the town to clear up all these things, but if I was a contractor that was owed money on this property, and somebody picked it up for a lot of money, I think it'd be nice to clear up those debts. And maybe I'm just a soft touch, but if we if we're owed $12,000 and we pick it up and it's worth $60 or $70 something, I'd be tempted to reimburse some of those people. Now, maybe I'm the lone ranger here.
Councilor Groff.
That's a nice sentiment, but I'm not so sure that you would be in a position of then of having to pick and choose who you reimburse. Obviously, there's IRS liens, there's different priorities, and I don't think that's our business. I think our business as a town is simply to follow the law, to protect the public treasury, to maximize our recovery, what's due to us. Also, I think it's our obligation in the town to, when there's property like this, it becomes under these clouds. It doesn't do the town any good. That property should be productive again and producing revenue for the town on a continuing basis, whether it's a house lot being built or someone else is buying it. And as to the underlying affairs of the person who once owned that lot, the legal process can take care of those people who are owed money by that person, and there's a long history here, and I, as a town council person, feel absolutely no responsibility whatsoever to either assist or harm anybody in that process. I am just totally focused on what's best for the collective town of Cape Elizabeth, the public entity, and I just don't think we can get sidetracked on what's good or not good for any one particular individual.
Anybody else? Councilor McGinty?
I took a ride over there and tried to identify which lot this was, and I'm not so sure I was able to do that. But I only raised one question, and I fully agree with what Councilor Groff says about maximizing our return on this property. Is there any consideration, or was there any consideration by the town manager perhaps holding this parcel as a, perhaps a neighborhood park of some sort? And I'm not sure how that parcel fits in over there, so I'm not sure that's even a viable idea. But if someplace down the road we're looking for a neighborhood park at Elizabeth Farms, I don't know, just throw that out for any discussion whatsoever.
Councilor Reed.
Those are 4-acre lot homes, John. They have their own fields and recreational areas in their yards, in my opinion.
Councilor Jordan.
No, I just want to say, because I don't know, I have to go to the attorneys for this and the people that's in it, that if we take it, get the money as far as the taxes owed to the town, do other people that have an interest here come upon the town?
No.
So if we sell it for more than what we get in it for taxes, that's a profit to the town.
Yes, sir.
Okay. That's correct.
Councilor Groff?
And just so we're all clear here, as much as I think the Internal Revenue Service is a wonderful entity, I would rather have the town of Cape Elizabeth have this money than reduce an individual's debt to the Internal Revenue Service that I didn't cause that individual to have. Or I would much rather a contractor that took a gamble and perhaps made a lot of money, Bill, in dealing with this individual on lots of things. That's a risk of doing business. And my priority is just what's best for the town of Cape Elizabeth. That's a planned community. There already is substantial public land with the circle. This isn't an area of town. I feel that the town needs to own a piece of property. This is equitably, morally, we are justified in going forward and maximizing cash benefit for the town in this case.
Thank you. Councilor Coxell.
I have a question of the manager, since he just talked about selling the property for a fair market value. I would like to recommend that any monies over and above the expenses to the town, the unpaid taxes, researching all the information, that any monies above that go into the land acquisition account.
Would you like that as an amendment to the motion?
Yes.
Is there a second?
I'll accept that amendment.
And the seconder, Councilor Jordan, do you accept that amendment?
Yes.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Councilor Linnell.
I just wonder if we could fit a cappuccino machine in there somewhere.
In your dreams.
not in the motion.
Okay.
The seconder was not going to support that.
I would like to comment, though.
Yes, sir.
I think that this is kind of a messy situation, and I suppose there's benefit to cleaning it up.
Thank you.
And I certainly am not opposed to selling it. I guess the only thing I was thinking about was what we do with it, and I guess considering the messiness of the situation, I guess we might as well do it.
Okay. Any further comment? Councillor Reid.
I just think that's an excellent amendment.
Thank you.
I agree. All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you very much. That concludes the items on our regular agenda tonight, excuse me. One announcement I do want to make. We've alluded to this once or twice earlier in the meeting. At the March meeting will be on Wednesday, March 12th, rather than Monday, March 10th. Wednesday, March 12th for the next regular council meeting. We now have another time on our agenda when we have a discussion period for citizens to bring forward items that are not on the agenda that they would like to address. Is there anybody in the audience who would like to do that at this time? Okay. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, I'll use the opportunity. I should have mentioned at the beginning of the meeting, and I didn't. Some of you may have noticed that some of our fire trucks have been down at Jordan's Farm Market recently. You might have wondered what was going on. One of our fire trucks, the water tank in it, developed a very severe leak in that it was losing half of the water in the tank each and every evening. It became a serious problem. Some of the volunteers in the department, primarily led by Gilly Jordan, Michael Jordan, Jerry Murray, and Danny O'Brien, decided they were going to try to help the town by taking the tank out of the truck, by welding it, repairing it, and doing some other work. As a result of that, what we originally had planned to do was, in next year's budget, to do some of this work. As a result of them taking it out and their donated service, and the fact that we won't have to take it out a second time next year because we're going to be doing some repair work around it, the town is going to be saving a net of over $7,000 as a result of the citizens' efforts. And I really do want to publicly recognize particularly those four individuals and other members of the volunteer fire department who assisted them. The truck will be back in service in a short time, and there are some major other repairs that we're sending out at the same time that they're not able to do with the body of the truck around there, so we only do have to take the tank out once, and then there'll be some more money in next year's budget to finish the work. But as a result of their efforts, we're able to save about $7,000. Thank you.
Councillor Jordan.
I just want to say I think there ought to be a special thanks go to Danny O'Brien for the welding job that he done on this tank. I mean, it wasn't just a little patch job. He had quite a lot to do, and I think for the guy to come forward, and that's kind of his business anyway, come forward and volunteer to do it, I think he needs a special thanks.
I think it reinforces the volunteer spirit of the folks who serve on our fire department. We do very well. I'm going to entertain a motion that we go into executive session. I do want to announce that at this time, after we hopefully approve that motion, we will be going off the air. That will be the conclusion of the regular meeting this evening. I do not anticipate that we are coming back into regular session for any votes. If any decisions are to be made, though, we will come back into a regular session, and those will be announced at the next council meeting. Could we have a motion, please? Depend on somebody anyway. Councillor Linnell.
Yeah, I move that we go into executive session to discuss a personnel matter, upcoming negotiations with the police bargaining union, a property acquisition disposition matter.
I'll second.
All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Show the time is 9:32.
You're close, Joe.
Yeah, I'm not bad.